What I like to tell my students to think of if they have trouble memorizing something, to just simply instead of memorizing it, use an acronym for it. You can go. Thanks. Yeah. I have two more tomorrow. I'm going to make it up. Okay. Thank you. So think of an acronym if you need to. This was simple, but this is when I talked this down in D.C. My student said AHIP. Like, I don't know why they chose that, but they're like, oh, let's use AHIP. I was like, okay, that works. And they did the behavior. So A for asymptotes, and I put N in behavior. Because remember, horizontal asymptotes and slant asymptotes are really the end behavior. So A is for asymptotes, find your vertical, horizontal, slant. H is for holes. I is for your intercepts, X and Y intercepts. And P is what we haven't done yet, but this is the easiest part. P is just picking points in between and plugging them into the function to help you make a smooth curve. So parts 1, 2, and 3 we've done, right? This was partially E1. This part of this was E2. This was E1, this was E3. So we're literally just doing all of these different things. Is that clear what I'm saying? Now, if, maybe next year I'll push myself to rewrite these notes, I just haven't had time to do it. If you want to, and you don't want to see what's happening, don't scroll down. Some of you don't benefit from seeing the answer ahead of time. I'm gonna be honest and be straight up with you guys. Some of you can read through my notes and be like, oh, I get that, that's great, and go and do the homework, no problem. But I think others of you really need to do it yourself and see it done. So if you are being a little bit misled because there's a lot of writing and you're just reading through it thinking you understand it, and then on the quiz or on the homework you're lost, I recommend you don't look at the solution yet. And we just look at this part. And I'll slowly move through the solution. Okay? So for all of these problems, the best thing to do to start is to factor. Whatever you can factor anything, start by factoring. Top, can that be factored? No. Bottom? Yes. What does the bottom factor into?
X minus 1, x plus 1.
Difference of squares. So let's start by factoring automatically. And there we have the factor form. Now, once we have the factor form, we can jump right into the work. Let's start to really understand this better today. And for the three, I think three of you that came for extra help today, I think it really helped by seeing how they're all related. But I think we need a little bit more practice on this thing. And the practice that we're going to see here is this. Recognize that the denominator gives you something. What does the denominator give you? Or? Very good. Well done. The denominator gives you either the vertical asymptotes or the holes. That's all it gives you. Now, when is it a hole? If the factor repeats. When is it a vertical asymptote? If the factor that's down here does not repeat. So do you see a repeated factor in the numerator from the denominator? I sure don't. So these are both then what? What are they?
Vertical asymptotes.
What are the equations of those vertical lines? What are the equations? What are the equations? What is the equation of the vertical asymptote from this one? Mark?
X equals 1.
And this one?
Negative.
X equals negative. Remember, these are vertical asymptotes. Vertical lines. They always say x equals. They don't just say 2 or 7. What is 2 on a graph? 2 means nothing to me on a graph. Nothing. It doesn't even mean a coordinate, right? If you tell me that the y-intercept is up at 7, at least I know it's 0, 7. But I need a full coordinate or I need an equation when I'm on a graph, right? I cannot just say 2 or 5 or 8. I have to say x equals 2 for a vertical line or y equals 2 for a horizontal line. Or y equals 2x plus 7 for a slant asymptote, depending upon what I'm doing, right? So I need to make sure that I understand that that has to be written that way. So that's what's on the next line right there. And this is literally what I'm saying, right? Since no factors repeat themselves in the numerator and denominator, then there's the holes. Done with H. Right? A, done with H. Then next, we say there are two vertical asymptotes because of these denominators. Negative 1 and positive 1. Coming from here, -1, positive 1. So I've got my holes done. I'm gonna go on the side and do this. Holes are done. Asymptotes, are we done? Halfway, right? We have the vertical. What else do we need now?
The horizontal.
Good, I like that you said or. Why'd you say or? Or is right, not and. Or is right there. I score.
Because either one of the
other occurs. Write this down. You never have a slant and horizontal asymptote for the same function. Any rational function can have multiple vertical asymptotes as many as you want, but you can only have one horizontal asymptote or one slant asymptote. You can't have both a horizontal and a slant asymptote. It's one or the other.
Did we get rid of most of the stoppers?
The rubber stoppers?
Yeah.
I have about 8 of them in there that I'm using for like an experiment. You remember there's like a spinning
yes.
experiment?
Yes.
So they're all here.
Yes.
Let me promise, if you don't mind. Scroll down a little bit further, please. Go to the next part. Scroll down a little bit further. Let me promise that they're tied in a way that they're at specific lengths. So if you don't mind, you can use them. But just try to cut as close to there as possible.
Okay.
Cut right here. Don't cut it over here.
Yes,
it's scored all along.
I understand.
So if you want to keep a pair of scissors, just cut them over here. Because these are going to be messy to bring down the line.
You'll only choose the right side.
They should all be the same. At least when I grab it for you, I hope they're the same, because the man shouldn't see it.
If they're in the right size,
you can just cut them off, and then I'll pay attention.
Yeah, and you say cut it.
Yeah, just if you don't mind cutting it close, so I'm not through.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The reason that there's only one, it can only be one, is because it depends on the case, right?
Correct. The case is what depends. The degree of the numerator is less than the denominator, it's a slant. It's a horizontal. The degree of the numerator is equal, it's a horizontal. The degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator, it's a slant asymptote. So it's only one of those three cases. That is exactly why, Mauro. You cannot have multiple cases for the same function. So when we scroll down, we're going to see this here in the next statement. We take a look at our degrees. The degree of the numerator is 1. The degree of the denominator is 2. I get that from the original function. Make sure you see that, please. Make sure you see that. Some people have a question, I should say, and saw this as a degree of 1. This is not a degree of 1. Each of these have a degree of 1, but they're multiplied, right? So it's really a degree of 2. If I have 3 factors, it's a degree of 2. If I have 4 factors, it's a degree of 4, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator. This is just literally memorization, right? There's no need to derive it. You did your homework. That's a lot of work. You can do that. Way too much work, right? So if you know that the degree of the numerator is less than the denominator, it's automatically a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0. It's memorization. For this one case, it's memorization. Okay, then there's the one with the leading coefficients when they're equal degrees. And then the one with the slanted asymptote, it's not memorization. You have to do a little bit of work. But this one is really just memorization. What is the line y equals 0? What is it physically?
The x-axis.
It's the x-axis. Write yourself a note if you didn't know that. Okay, write yourself a note. So I've got my asymptotes, right? We've got vertical and we've got horizontal. Check, done. And no holes, so for the holes, let me put an X actually. I'll make this into an X for the horizontal. There's no horizontal.
So we've got both a vertical and a horizontal asymptotes are and no holes for each. I stands for?
Intercepts.
How many types of intercepts do we have for all functions? Types, not number, types. Helen? Yeah, they are x and y. We can have several x-intercepts, you know that, right? We can only have one y-intercept at most ever. You can never have more than one y-intercept, though, it's not a function. Because if you get more than one y-intercept, the graph would have to do this, right? Here's your y-axis, we have to cross, come back and cross again. And wouldn't that fail the vertical line test then? So it wouldn't be a function, right? These are rational functions. There will only ever be one at most y-intercept. But there can be as many x-intercepts as are given in the problem.
Again, there can be multiple x-intercepts. I could have a graph that does this. Ready? Up and down, up and down, up and down. That's crossing the x-axis like 8 times. But if it crosses the y-axis more than once, it fails the vertical line test and it's not actually a function. So we are looking at only functions here. So let's jump ahead to the intercepts. To find the y-intercept, we always
set x to 0. Really? I mean, it's so easy to find the y-intercept. So easy. Look at the original. Don't use a factor form, by the way. A lot of you guys use a factor form after this. This is useful for holes and intercepts and the x-intercepts in a minute. a hole is an asymptote, it's an x-intercept, but not the y-intercept. It doesn't make sense. Plug a zero here. That becomes zero. Over, that's a zero, negative one. Zero over negative one. What's zero divided by negative one? Just zero. So my y-intercept is zero, comma, zero. There it is. Okay? Again, I evaluate the function when x is zero. By plugging a zero in those two spots, which gives me zero over negative one, which is zero. So I have x, which is zero, and y, which is zero. Well, if that's my y-intercept, Eduardo, you said it yesterday. 2 days ago? 2 days ago, yeah. You said it.
If that's your y-intercept, would you be there?
Fill in the blank.
Oh,
If that's your y-intercept, then...
That's going to be your x-intercept.
Good. Whenever 0, 0 is an x-intercept, it's also a y-intercept, or vice versa. So you know that that will be an x-intercept. Can we prove that that's true? Sure. How do we find the x-intercepts?
You have to plug into the factored form, like the simplified one.
How do we find the x-intercepts
oh.
in general, in math, in all of your life in math?
Set second. Y equals 0.
Thank you. Whenever you want the x-intercept, we set y equal to 0. There it is. Okay? So note that we're plugging 0 into y in the factored form. This is useful for the factored form, but the key was plugging 0 for y. So doing that gives us the following equation. Right? Here's the factored form, up here. Take it, bring it down, set the function equal to 0. This is the y value, right? m of x is y. Set y equal to 0. When can a fraction equal 0? When can a fraction equal 0? Only if. Francisco, you want to answer it? Take it down. Only if the numerator equals 0. So the denominator, didn't we use this already? What did the denominator give us again? What did the denominator give us?
The asymptotes and holes.
Yeah, either the holes or the asymptotes. In this case, it was vertical asymptotes, right? So I don't care about the denominator. The numerator is the only thing that can equal 0 for a fraction equals 0. So set the numerator equal 0. What do you get for x? You get 0. Well, again, we set y equal to 0. We got 0 here. X turns out to be 0, which is a 0 there. And lo and behold, 0, 0 is the intercept for both. Because again, if you have 0, 0 as an x-intercept, you have to have 0, 0 as a y-intercept. Now, so far so good? Any questions about this? We're going to get to more of this question, so we're not done. So go ahead. We're going to continue this problem. Any questions so far on this problem? Sebastian.
The x-intercept, so I'm missing the algebra portion, so that's why.
Okay. Set y equal to 0. It was m of x over here, which is y, and that equals 0. And this says 0 equals a fraction, right? When can 0 equal a fraction if the numerator equals 0? Because if the denominator equals 0, that's no good, right? So we take the numerator and set it equal to 0. And then solving, we get x equals 0 divided by 2. 0 divided by 2 is still 0. Okay, Valentina?
How can the y-intercept be 0 if the horizontal asymptote is 1?
That's a great question. I was waiting for that one. So remember what I talked about? The horizontal asymptote can be crossed. The verticals cannot. Again, the horizontal asymptote can be crossed by the function, but the vertical asymptote cannot be crossed. Write that down in big letters, okay? Vertical asymptotes cannot be crossed, meaning the function goes right over the asymptote, right? But horizontal asymptotes can be crossed or intersected with, whichever way you want to write it. It's a great question, Valentina. And I'm going to wait a second to go even further and answer it because we're going to show the graph now, okay? But yeah, that's a great question. It can be crossed. It can be crossed. So what do I have so far? Let me go to the next slide before I show it to you. I don't want you to see the whole thing. So what do I have so far? Here's what I have so far. Ready? That's what I've got so far. You can slide to the next slide, but try not to look at the answer yet. Please try not to look at the answer yet. I want you to see what we got so far. Helen, we got two vertical asymptotes, right? What color are they?
Blue.
Where's the horizontal asymptote? Red. Is that clear on the graph, right? This is x equals negative 1,
This is x equals positive 1. This is the line y equals 0. This is the y-intercept. This is the x-intercept.
So do I have enough information to graph this yet?
No.
I know that I've got regions. I know that I've seen 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 regions, it looks like. See, remember I talked about these as boundaries? Imagine your dashed lines, your asymptotes, are like fences. Usually the function stays in that region. This one will cross clearly, right? And then this one maybe will stay in the region. How do I get those other points? I need to use a logical method. So what do you think I should do? The last part of A hit is to pick applicable points. What do I mean by that? Pick applicable points. If you're not sure, zoom out, and look at the table on the left. The answer's on the bottom right now, you'll see that. But what do I mean by pick applicable points? Christian, why is it important that the points I select make sense? Why am I not just picking 37,485 for x? Yeah, we're really trying to look at the boundaries here. So we want to look at x values in this area, x values in this area, x values in this area. So in that middle region, my x values only go from negative 1 to 1, right? So I need to pick decimals, and look what I did. I chose 1 half and negative 1 half. I chose 3 quarters and negative 3 quarters. So this right here are the 4 points that I'm using for the middle region of the graph. I've got the y values, don't I? For each of these? So I can just simply plot them on the screen. Notice the symmetry. Look at the y coordinates. They're exact opposites of each other. That's the symmetry about the origin. What are you looking for? Got it?
Yeah.
It's right, the wire's
rubber banded next to it. And the glue sticks are up there as well if you need them.
Yeah,
okay. The top portion of my table represents the left part of the graph. And the bottom portion of my table represents the right part of the graph. But notice, what x value did I skip over on purpose? What x value am I skipping over on purpose? Very good, because what would I get if I plug 1 in? Or negative 1 in? What would I get? Undefined. It doesn't help me. So don't plug in the asymptotes in the table. They don't make any sense. Now, how did I choose numbers to the right? It's kind of arbitrary, to be honest. Like, I saw that this was at 1, right? Take a look, so it's at 1. I kind of want to see the curvature, so I chose 1 and a half. Then I chose 2. Then I skipped, instead of 2 and a half, I went to 3. So sometimes it's about getting used to doing this more and more to know which numbers to pick. But you want to pick numbers that are pretty close to the asymptote. That's why I chose 1.5, where 3/4 is really close to 1. That's why 3/4 was chosen. And then as you get further from the asymptote, you can separate these gaps more. So maybe the next point you choose is 5, and then you choose 10, because it's not going to see much of a change. But when you're near the asymptote, you see a lot of change. So you want points that are pretty close to the asymptote. So again, it's all about practice. Practice. We will do 9 examples in class, 9. Okay, because this is a topic that I find at the end of the year, students struggle because they're not practicing enough. So we're spending 2 days on this, and then you have 6 examples for homework to look at over the weekend. You have a promise to do on Monday that involves examples. Actually, did I give you a promise of assignment you wanted to do for? I don't think I did. Okay, so what you should do, you know those 3 documents I put under documents in handout? You should practice those things. There's no assignment to turn in, though, for the problem set for E1, 3, 4. 5, 6, and 5, 7 as problem set questions you will turn in. So your problem set 12 that's due on Monday is extremely short. It's only 5, 6, and 5, 7. E1, E2, E3, E4, use the documents I put under documents in handouts to practice them more. I didn't do a problem set for this because there's no problems in your textbook. Okay? Yes?
So the test is 5, 6, 5, 7, then.
Which is really just E4, right? Because if you can do E4, you can do the rest.
Does that make sense what I'm saying by that? If you do E4, you're doing everything else anyway. So it's not like you have to do all of them separately, but it's useful to know that they're all combined. Okay, that was a lot of talking. Let's jump into the second one.
Factors. Numerator factors into? Good.
Denominator, factors. More.
2.
No need to take factor. If you took a 2 out, it'd be x squared plus 1 half.
Right.
So I would not factor the denominator. I would leave it. Okay, and that's what we have right here. Okay? Now, here's the problem. If I factor the denominator, I get either two things, right? Radical asymptotes or holes. Again, factors of the denominator give me vertical asymptotes or poles. But this one doesn't fact, unfortunately. But I still want to know what makes the denominator zero, don't I? Is that the whole premise here? The whole premise behind domain restrictions are what makes the denominator equal to zero? That's the whole premise. So go ahead and set the denominator equal to zero. When I do that, what do I get as an answer? Solve this in your head. Ready? Do it. Move a 1 over. That's a negative 1. Divide by 2. That's negative 1 half. Take the square root. So I get this as an answer. X equals plus or minus the square root of negative 1 half. But what's the square root of a negative number? Imaginary. Okay? No vertical asymptotes. No holes, no vertical asymptotes. Life is good. Life is good. Not too much to worry about. Let's see what else we've got. Okay, so holes are done. And then we've got the vertical or the horizontal slash slant, and no vertical there. Okay, so no vertical, maybe we have a horizontal or slant. Take a look at the degrees. The degree of the top is 2. The degree of the bottom is 2. When the degrees are the same?
It's the ratio of leading coefficients.
It's y equals the ratio of the leading coefficients. What's my coefficient right here?
1.
And then 2, so it's just 1 over 2. Okay, 1/2. Oops. And there it is.
Okay. So do I have a slant asymptote? Could I?
No. Because once I have horizontal, I'm done. I have either horizontal or slant asymptotes.
So here's what I want you to do tonight.
Tonight, I want you to finish example 2. You don't have homework in this year tomorrow, right? And I want you to go on to do example 3. So finish 2 and do example 3. Tomorrow you're going to do example number 4. If you're confused about this and want to ask questions, you can, by all means. But I want you to finish 2 and go through 3. Try to do it on your own and then use the notes to help you. We'll pick up with example 4 tomorrow. I'll give you the quiz back tomorrow as well.
What's the other state?
Can you tell Julia?
Yeah.
You talk to her a lot, yeah. Tell her if she wants to come in during activities, it's first period tomorrow. Do you guys have period leaders as freshmen? You do, never mind. Alex doesn't, so he's coming in activities, that's fine. But you can let her know that we got through examples 1, half of 2, and they have to finish 3. Same thing, Helen, if you want to let Alex know examples 1, 2, and 3, watch the video tonight for him. The dashed line.
A solid line takes precedent over a dashed line, so the function itself is along the slant asymptote the entire time. No matter where you look, it's on the slant asymptote, so you don't see the slant asymptote here.
Why are we using division?
Because whenever the degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator, we know it's a slant asymptote, and to find a slant asymptote, we use either long or synthetic division. The top by the bottom. You gotta go back and look at your notes. You struggle with this on the quiz too. Come see me, we'll go over it. Okay, but you take the top over the bottom. Just make a synthetic table, 1, 1, negative 12, and take whatever the bottom is, plug it in. You end up getting this, right? This will give you negative 4 and 1, it'll give you negative 3. That'll be 12 and negative 12, that'll be 0. So this gives me x minus 3. And there's my slant asymptote, right? That's where it comes from.
But it's the same exact thing as the actual simplified form.
Okay. Slide on to example 6, please. Try to do example 6 without looking ahead. I'm going to give you guys about, I don't know, like 2 minutes to factor and get to what you can get through here. Try that one before we do it together. Okay, example 7 is one I want to do together, and that's an interesting one. I'm gonna jot some notes down. Don't look up if you don't want to see. But I want to show you how, just from the fact of form alone, pretty much come up with everything, which is right below right here. There's a lot of words below this, right? I do a lot of typing there so you can understand it. But I can literally start just doing this. Done with that part. Then next, I can make this statement somewhere. I can do that. So, in about a total time of maybe a minute and a half, look at everything you can come up with. And it's all back to your factoring skills. It really is. You gotta be able to factor. But after that, you gotta know what each thing is doing. The denominator causes either wholes or vertical asymptotes. No repeated factor. By default, we've got two vertical asymptotes. And then go to the next part and say, okay, I've got an x-intercept at 4, 0, because that causes the numerator to become 0. I'm done. And then say my y-intercept is just setting x to 0. That becomes -4/0, which is undefined. That makes sense that the y-intercept is undefined because I've got a vertical asymptote of x equals 0. What's the horizontal asymptote here? What's the horizontal asymptote?
Good, very good. Again, the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator, which tells me y equals 0 is my horizontal asymptote.
And no hole on the graph is no repeated factor. Everything's gone right here. Just by looking at the factor form, I can list everything on it. Then I have to go to the next step, graph what I know so far, and then think about what points I have to plug into a table. Try to figure out this next part without looking at the points I choose. Try not to look ahead at the table and think about what points would be useful for you. And use the graph that I give you as a sketch of this, like a mental sketch. Julia?
I think it's the x and y intercepts from that.
So the x-intercept always comes from setting the function equal to 0. And if I set a fraction equal to 0, the only way a fraction can equal 0 is if the numerator equals 0. So if the numerator equals 0 and I solve this, what do I end up getting? And that gives me the x-intercept. The y-intercept comes from setting x to 0 always. 0 minus 4 is -4. 0 and 0 is 0. -4/0. Okay? Treat it the same way you've done any other function in the past. Set x to 0 to get the y-intercept, set y to 0 to get the x-intercept. The only caveat is to recognize that the denominator does not give you x-intercepts. It's the numerator that could be 0 to give you x-intercepts. Okay? So here's the mental sketch of what we just drew, or what we just wrote down. We've got two vertical asymptotes in blue. It's tough to see the one on the y-axis. We've got one x-intercept. We've got no y-intercepts. And that's all. That's all we've got right now. So this is going to be a funky looking graph. Let's think about some x and y values that might be useful for us. I want to pick x values near my asymptotes, right? So to the left of 0, what points might I choose? To the left of 0, what points might I choose for x to plug in?
-1 or
sure. -1/2, -1, -2 or 3, maybe -6. Very good. So now you start close to the asymptote, pick a couple points close, and then kind of spread out a little bit further, right? Same thing to the right of the number 3, right here. To the right of x equals 3, what
choose like 3.5. Am I gonna choose 4? Am I gonna choose 4 as one of my x values? No, it's my x-intercept, right? I'm just gonna get 0 if I try. Try 4, I get 0. So I choose 3.5, 5, 6, maybe 7 or 8 or something. And then in here it's where it's a little bit weird. You gotta pick something really close here, so like 0.5, maybe 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, a couple of those 0.5s in between, and get your whole list of values and plot your coordinates. Yeah.
Can it be on the
No. It can never be on, because that would be then considered crossing. It can be on the horizontal, though, which it clearly is, right? Yeah, the x-intercept here, right?
You guys, I mean, this is a clear violation of asymptotes, but again, not horizontal or slant. The x-intercept is on the horizontal asymptote, but it can't be on the vertical. It can't be on the vertical.
So here's my list of coordinates I am choosing. Where's my table? Here we go. So here's the coordinates I chose.
Reasonable, same ones you would have chosen. Okay, some stuff to the left of this, a couple points in between, and then a couple points to the right of this guy. I mean, that's the behavior of the graph. A little bit funky, right? A little bit funky here. I don't know, is this one gonna eventually cross? Is this one gonna eventually cross? What do you think? No, how come? How come? Because I can't tell, maybe it could. How come you know for sure?
Right.
Well, now you know the answer. Figure out the reason. Why will this function never cross this horizontal asymptote going left?
Because of the symmetry for both sides.
Hmm? I like that idea, but not that. Weird symmetry in this graph. It's a little funny.
It's only one x-intercept.
Yeah. When we solve the x-intercepts, how many did we get? One, right? That's right here. Okay, so the crossing would be an x-intercept. A sine function, like I showed earlier, that little wave, crosses infinitely many times. So that's a little different, right? But a polynomial over a polynomial, these polynomial over polynomials are rational functions here, will have x-intercepts that we solve for, and those ones will be the only points where we cross horizontal asymptote. Okay, and x equals 4 was the only x-intercept here. That's why we only cross once, yes.
Can I be a dumb question?
No.
How did you get your y values?
Plugged them into the original function.
Oh.
Or, honestly, the simplified form works best. If you can simplify a function, you could plug all of these x values here into the simplified form of the function to make it a lot easier for calculations. If you're doing this, I'm telling you now, which you will, you're going to do at least one of these full without a calculator at all. And if you're going to do it without a calculator whatsoever, it can be tedious if you don't have a table, right? So use the simplify form to plug these x coordinates into. You'll get the same answer as you would have gotten. Because the simplified form is just canceling factors, right? So it won't affect the answer you're getting. So again, plug these in to the simplified form. There is no simplified form here because there was no hole in the graph. There's only ever a simplified form if there's a hole in the graph. Yes.
I'm also confused on how do you like pick your
So my x values want to be very close to the asymptotes and then spread further as I get further. So since this is at 0, right, x equals 0, this is at x equals 3. From x equals 0, when I go left, I chose negative 0.5 first. So that was a half a unit away, right? Then negative 1 was another half a unit. Then this was a full unit away. Then this was 2 units away. Do you see how I'm increasing the gap? That's how you do it, literally. So then you start to the right of 0, a half unit away, a half unit away, a full unit away, but then a half unit away again because I'm getting closer to the next asymptote. And then I do the same thing here. I'm starting at 3, so I chose 3.5, 4, and then actually in this case I chose 3.5 and just 5 because 4 was my x-intercept. So what I want to do is choose x values near the asymptotes, but then as you move away, increase the gaps between each successive point. Yeah? Okay. It's a great question because I'm sure others have been wondering the same thing. Yeah.
Let's say on the test, how many points do you want us to put for each side?
So it should be reasonable. If you have only one vertical and one horizontal asymptote, 3 or 4 points to the right, 3 or 4 points to the left.
Here, though, it was a little trickier, right? Because there were really 6 regions. We had really like 3 x regions to choose. So a couple points to the left, a couple points between, a couple points to the right. Yeah? So each section you have, based on how many vertical asymptotes, will dictate how many x coordinates you should test.
Okay? The last one is my favorite one because you're not given an actual function. So work with the person next to you on this. Work with the person next to you. Just discuss.
Okay, there's three here, that's fine. So two, 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 two. All I want you to do is go through this process and think out loud or to each other, what could the function look like that would have these things? Okay, think about factors. You can answer all the factors. I don't want a long polynomial over a long polynomial. I want it all based on factors. Okay, go ahead and go through this process for a little while.1 minute, we'll discuss in 1 minute.
Oh, the, yeah. What do you
with the extra. With the extra x, I fill the hole. You don't need the x, it's three. No need, right?
You have to run it.
Y equals some number, the degrees are the same. Remember, because that's when it's the ratio of the coefficient to the front.
Oh, okay.
So the ratio of the coefficient to the front should be 3/1. So you could put like a 6 and 2, 4, 9 and 3, or 12 and 4, but you're not gonna tack on the next cube.
Okay.
And you're just still missing your other two factors down there for the vertical asymptotes, right? Yeah.
I don't get how the x equals 0.
Set each factor equal to 0. When you set this equal to 0, you get x equals -2, right? When you set this equal to 0, what is it? It's the y-axis.
The way you do that
it's the y-axis. Every factor in the denominator is a vertical asymptote unless it's repeated with a factor above.
Okay.
And in that case, it's a whole. Okay?
Yes. Do you have office hours on Monday?
I have office hours every Wednesday morning. So if you want to come see me at another time, just send me an email. You can come by during a free or after school on Monday or Tuesday, that's fine. Tuesday's test is what period? Do you know?
Tuesday
is day 2. It's first period. So try to find a time Monday, or Monday after school is fine. I don't know. We're going to have baseball practice, but I could be an hour late to practice on Monday. That's fine. Okay? We'll probably go to Randall's at least 2 days next week, and I'll try to work them so that it's maybe Thursday and Tuesday, so it's better for me. You know?
Yeah.
So I could have extra help on Monday
after
school.
After this coming period, we go straight to the bus.
After 6 period, go right outside, yeah? But get equipment and stuff, make sure.
Yeah.
We need game balls, baseballs, the whole 9 yards.
Is it all in the it's
all in the same spot, too.
I'll share something quick to eat and then come back up.
Yeah. I'm here at this period.
Yeah.
So, is this a period or an F?
Yeah.
Actually, no. Why don't you, you're by lunch? You know, you're still at lunch. Let's work
right now.
So
you're
well, in the second half period, so it's probably better off if you.
Musical.
Oh, yeah. I mean, unless you can just wait until you have a good period, but if you need.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, because I'm going to get through the second.
So